Being able to introduce brand new Joggles products never gets old, and today I'm so thrilled to tell you about our newest, Shrines. From simple box shrines all the way up to a grandmother clock, we've got something for every taste. Like butterflies and wings, we have them. Or a smaller hut shrine, or a flat shallow shrine. We even have one with a decorative back made to look like a castle. In today's video, I'll demo the basics of assembling them and show you an awesome technique for embellishing the inside back. With the exception of the shallow shrines, and this is an example of one, everything else is built off of what I think of as a box. In this case, a box that is 3 inches by 5 inches, or this one, it's a 4x6 box, but that's where everything starts. And because everything is cut on a laser, what you need to be aware of is that it's cut with heat, and a certain amount of charring is going to happen. Now, I've already wiped these down quickly once, but you can see that there's a little bit of soot. That's the char from when the laser cuts with heat. You'll just want to quickly go over all your pieces and wipe that off. Now, in terms of how to embellish these, how to add color, there's as many ways as you can think of. You can put paper on the inside. You can paint on the inside. You can see that I've got a coat of gesso started here. Now, typically when I put a coat of gesso first, I'm going to put it on the pieces before they're assembled into the box. It just makes it a little bit easier. If you add paper, something that you should be aware of is that if your paper is thick enough, you might find that all of these joins here, which match up perfectly to begin with, might be off the tiniest bit. Honestly, it's so small you really don't need to worry about it, but it can happen. On this particular shrine, Bonnie Irvin used washi tape on these pieces, and so there's just kind of an unlimited number of ways that you can work with them. I'm going to show you basic assembly today, and that starts out with cleaning. Now, if you're going to paint, it's definitely easier to paint the pieces before you assemble the box. But for the sake of argument today, I'm going to show you the basic assembly, and I'm not going to worry about having painted these or not. Masonite is wood. It's a little bit shiny. I use the Aliens, the super thick tacky glue. It holds them together really well. And I use a toothpick because, again, I find it works really well. So what I'm going to do, you're always, when you work with the shrines, you'll always find that the long sides have the dip cut out so that when these go together, they simply go together like this. I like to put glue in there. So I'm going to, now here's the thing. The neater you are to begin with the glue, the easier this is going to be to clean up at the end. And you'll see what I mean in just a minute. So I'm just going to put some glue in here. Now, remembering that you're going to put these on some sort of a back, which will provide additional stability. You're not building the Eiffel Tower here. You're building a little bit of a shrine. And so it's never going to come under a whole lot of stress. So I guess what I'm telling you is you're not building a building. You're putting together a decorative element that's going to sit someplace or be hung someplace, so you don't need to feel as though you have to assemble this to the nth degree. So I'm going to slip the ends in here, and then I'm going to put this piece in here, and there is the box 3/4 of the way built. So I'll do the same thing on this edge here, get some glue in there. Again, I'm going to wipe the glue off the face because it's just going to make my life easier afterward from a cleanup and getting paint to adhere kind of perspective. So again, I'm going to slide this piece in here. Now, what I don't have handy, but that I'm going to tell you you should do, is a damp cloth or a damp paper towel. Because as you can see, the glue has kind of crept out of the seams a little bit, and that's perfectly natural. That's going to happen. But if you clean it up to begin with a damp cloth, and I'm just talking very lightly damp, take the excess off with one and then clean up the remainder with a damp cloth, then you'll find that you're not going to have paint behaving weirdly where it won't want to stick, or you're not going to feel a bulge where glue was. So once this is together, what you can do is put an elastic on it. And this will help hold the pieces in place. Now, obviously, you want this to be square. You don't want it racked into some sort of a parallelogram. So what I do is I can feel by squeezing like this, I can feel that that's square. But if you feel like you need some reassurance that it's square, bring the back in, set it on top, and with your fingers, you'll be able to feel that this, if it's racked one way or the other, you'll be able to feel that it's off. Once you're satisfied that this box is nice and square, put it to one side, let it dry, and then it's time to start thinking about other ways of embellishing. Whether you go into creating your shrine with a plan, you know exactly what it is that you want to do, or you're winging it, you're just going to play and see what happens, at some point you have to make a decision about what to do with the inside back of your shrine. And by that I mean this area that you see as white. This is our medium shallow shrine, and this sample was made by Bonnie Irvin. And what she did was cut a piece of paper that fits the inside dimensions, top to bottom and side to side, this area in here inside the frame. On this one, you can see, this is Virginia England's, you can see that Virginia has done much the same thing, but this time she's added some dimension, and by that I mean she put some gesso, black gesso, through a stencil. So not a ton of dimension, but still it's something that you have to bear in mind. And then this is also Virginia England's work. This is her prototype for the Wings Shrine, and you can see that there's all kinds of dimension. This is very 3D. It's very sticky uppy. There's lots of pieces that stand up inside there. And when you want to do something like this, there's certain allowances that you have to make. So let me slide this out of the way, and I will show you what I mean. So this is a back that I worked on, and you can see that there's this perimeter around the inside back where there is nothing on it. And that's important because when it comes time to sit the box on here and to glue this in place, you can see how this sits on there and it's nice and tight. There's nothing that's in the way that impedes that box sitting flush on the back. And so there's a method to the madness to get you there. And the way to do this, and I can't take credit for this at all, this is all Virginia England's idea. She showed me how to do this. So what you're going to do is you're going to trace the box, and you can see that I've already done that. You can see the pencil lines in there. You're going to trace the inside of the box on your back. And so what you'll do is you'll put that box on there, and you can align this with your fingers. You can feel that it's aligned here and on both sides. And then you're going to take your pencil and you're going to mark around the inside. Now bear in mind that you want to get the tip of that pencil as tightly into that crevice where the back meets the side as possible, but you always are going to end up with a crevice that's, with a mark that's actually in a little bit more than it should be. And what happens when that happens is that, and it's not super noticeable here, but if I skew this so it's really noticeable, see right here? See that narrow strip, that area where there is no green stuff? That's because I made this a little bit too wide, and I'll show you the channel that I mean by a little bit too wide. And so the way to get around that is how you place your tape. So this is the channel that's created when you trace around the box, and it actually sticks in a little bit too much. So when it comes time to put your tape on, because you're going to use painter's tape, which is going to allow you to put texture paste on here, when you do this, you're actually going to put your tape in the inside of that line. You want to put your tape so that it's aligned right to the inside edge of your pencil mark as closely as possible. Again, you don't want to come too far out, because if this channel gets too narrow, then you're not going to get the back sitting on there. So you just have to eyeball this until you've got it on there, get the tape on, tape that in place. Turn it around, do the same thing here. And again, I'm going to be very careful. I'm going to be very careful to get that tape on that pencil mark in such a way that I'm just inside the mark, so that I know that I'm not going to make this channel too wide. Do the same thing here. And then eventually I'll do something on the other side, and you'll see that in 1 second. But you're going to end up, now this is one of the wings, you're going to end up with something that looks like this. And this is made of texture paste. And then it's, now Prima makes a similar product, but they've been kind of hard to get lately. So when Artsy came out with these, I decided to go ahead and try them. But whether you use Prima's Artstoons or this Artsy texture stuff, it'll work. So we have big boulders, we have smaller stones, and then we have what they call texture sand, which is little tiny granules that I actually like a lot. I prefer this over Prima's texture powder because there's a little bit more dimension to it. So I'm going to come back in 1 second, we'll get out the texture paste, and I'm going to show you how to go from this to this. I'm all taped up and ready to start adding texture paste. This is just Ranger's standard matte texture paste. It's the opaque stuff, and it's pretty light and fluffy, so I'm just going to use a palette knife and start putting this on here. Now, you can go thin, you can go thick, you can go thin in some places and thicker in others in kind of a high-low pattern. However you want to do it is entirely up to you. You also can leave some areas like that little corner right there or someplace else along the edge. You can leave that without texture paste. It's kind of six of one, half a dozen of the other. It really is a play process for me to see what happens. But I do like the idea of high and low areas, and some of that can be built with the stones and the texture sand. But the first thing you got to do is get the texture paste on there. Now, this jar must have had the cover left off because this paste is a little bit thicker than normal, which is why it's giving me a little bit of trouble as I start to spread this. But if you have a brand new jar or one that you actually properly close the lid on, then you're not going to run into that business that I just had there a second ago. Not that it's any big deal, but still. So I'm going to build now some high and some low areas. And I'm just going to do that by more or less piling the texture paste on in spots. And then once I have that done, maybe put some in this corner up here. Now the thing to bear in mind is you don't want to gunk too much stuff around the edges where your tape is, primarily because you're going to have to take the tape off and there's no point in making that job any more difficult than it has to be. But I'm pretty satisfied with this. So for now I'm going to put the cover on my texture paste and I'm going to just wipe the paste off of the palette knife so it doesn't dry on there and ruin my palette knife. And in come the stones. So these giant ones are called boulders, and then these are called pebbles, and then there's the, whoops, sorry, let's bring this into the shot so you can see it. So boulders, pebbles, and then texture sand. Same thing in the Prima line, although as I said, I do prefer the texture sand in the Artsy line because it's actually got some dimension to it. They're little teeny, teeny pebbles. So I like to start with the biggest elements first, and it actually doesn't take that many of these. So I'm just going to take a few, and you can go random if you want, and then you can just kind of press them in place, which is what I'm going to do, and then I kind of let the other stuff get built around that. So that looks pretty good. I don't want to put too many of the big ones in there, especially since this is a 3x5. You know, it could overwhelm it. So next, I'm going to work with the boulders, and excuse me, with the pebbles, and you can see that these are quite a lot smaller. So again, I'm just going to randomly drop them on there, and if I want to monkey with things a little bit, and if I want to build up areas with more of the stones and maybe push some away from other places, I can certainly do that. Because I'm working on a 3x5, you know, there's a little bit more limited space here to work with. So I think I'm just going to kind of cluster these around here. Whoops. Cluster these around here. Chase them as they roll off the paper. And this is the process. I mean, that's how simple this is. I'm going to put the rest of the stones back in the jar. These are pebbles, actually. And then I'm going to bring out the sand. So this I'm actually going to just pour on. And you can see that these are super tiny, and they have a tendency to cling a little bit easier than the bigger ones do. But I'm always going to come and kind of press this stuff in place. And it's this fine line between pressing too hard so that you push down the dimension that you so carefully built, and then pressing not enough so that the stuff doesn't really adhere, and by the stuff I mean the various sizes of stones and pebbles, so that it doesn't actually adhere to the texture paste itself. So I'm pretty satisfied with this. I'm going to leave this alone, and here comes now the exercise in patience. You really should let this dry before you take the next step. So I'm going to do that, but I'm going to put this to one side, and I'm going to bring in the wings that you saw a few moments ago, because that's long since dry and it's ready to go. Once the texture paste is dry, the next step is to add some colors using, and again, this is Virginia's method, using the Lindy Starburst sprays. But before you do that, you should take your piece over to the trash and brush off anything on there that's loose. No matter how hard you think or how well you think you pressed all those little bits into the paste, some of it is not going to have adhered, and you want to get that out of there before you run through these next steps. So I'm going to use three colors of Lindy Starburst sprays. I'm going to shake them to make certain that all of the mica and pigment is distributed through the liquid, and then it's just a matter of starting to spray and add color. I'm going to put a little bit of yellow on first. It's not going to be my primary color. I plan on letting it mix with the pink and the blue so that I get some kind of orange and green tones So I'm just going to put a little bit in here. Then I'm going to come in with this magenta color. And then lastly, I'm going to come in with the blue. If I think that this needs some more of anything, I can certainly come in and add it. So I'm going to add some more of the yellow. As it happens, I kind of like that in there, so I'm going to make that a little bit more dominant than maybe I had planned to originally. So this is what you end up with, and now comes the waiting game again. So you're going to have to wait for all of this to dry before you can add the next steps, which is going to be using Art Glitters Gala Glitz. It's got all these little teeny beads, all of this glass glitter that's in there, and it really adds some interesting dimension. And then we'll come in, you can either use in the Art Alchemy line that Finovere has developed for Prima, there are those new waxes and pastes, you can use them. You can use Inca Gold. I'm going to use Inca Gold just because I happen to have some here today. But the first thing is you got to let this stuff dry. With all of the Lindys dry, before I go ahead and add Inca Gold or I add the Gala Glitz, I want to take the tape off. I want to see what this looks like because right now a lot of it is hidden under the tape. And so for me, the best way to get an idea about what I want to do is to just go ahead and take it off. And you can see that even though there's texture paste on there, it comes right off. So let's get this edge going here. And this is really kind of the big reveal. And I think that this really gives you a better feel for the piece rather than having it everything hidden under the tape. And one of the first things that you're going to notice is that the Lindys and all of the mica that goes along with it, and let's just kind of slide this out of the way for a moment. I'll get a clean piece. All of the Lindys and the mica that's part of it, you can see, has accumulated in various places. Now, I will tell you, I came back with some creme brulee cream. I wanted to add some more glimmer, and this really doesn't add all that much in the way of color, but it has really wonderful, really wonderful gold mica in the bottom. So I did come back and I did that. So the next step is going to be, and I can see where I've actually oversprayed, so a word to the wise, when you're spraying your Lindys, you probably want to cover, I can clean this off, but you'll probably want to cover any other area if you've got wings. If you've just got a box, then it's no big deal. But if you've got things sticking out like this, or the butterfly wings, or the castle, any of those things, the sunburst, you'll want to block them off so that they don't get colored too. So the next thing I want to do is bring in some Inca Gold. And as I said, I could use the new Art Alchemy paste that Finovere and Prima have come out with. This is what I have on hand. So what I want to do is I want to just add some highlights. And I think I'm going to do that with the champagne. So I'm just going to touch this a little bit with my finger. You can see that I've got a little on there. And I'm going to come in and just add some color to the high areas. And I can do as much or a little of this as I want. And I can get the areas of texture paste too. I don't necessarily have to limit myself to just doing those big stones. Since this got pretty dark, I think I'm going to just probably stick to the champagne, even though I could bring the other colors in. I think that this is going to help lighten it a little bit in spots. This is darker than I normally work. I like it, but it's definitely darker than I normally work. And this is just the process. And once you're satisfied, then the next step will be coming in with that Gala Glitz. So I'm going to actually hit some areas kind of hard. I want to really get some gold on there, or some, this is more of a champagne color, it's a lighter yellow. And I'm liking the way that this looks. This is, all of these things that you do are just ways to add more interest, to really highlight those elevated areas so that you can really see them. All right, so we'll probably call that done. And this stuff dries pretty quickly. I'm not worried about letting it quote-unquote dry before I come in with the next step. So I have several colors of the Gala Glitz, and if I hold them this way, well, let's try to get that without the glare. If I hold them that way, you can see I've got one that's pretty green, one that's turquoisey teal, and one that is gold. I think I'm going to go with the turquoisey teal one, and I'm going to bring in, because you've got non-porous things in here like beads and glass glitter, you need to use an appropriate adhesive. And since the super thick tacky glue is a multi-surface adhesive, I'm going to just go ahead and use that. Now I'm going to grab some of this with my finger, just kind of move it around here, And then this is completely random, however you want to do this. And I tend to do this a little bit at a time. One of the things that you'll notice is that you may pick up some of the stones and some of the pieces. That's just kind of what happens, even though you've brushed all that loose stuff off. There just ends up being some left. So I can't, again, take credit for the coffee filter idea. This is Elle's from Elizabeth Crafts. I'm just going to wipe this glue up for a second, who showed me how to do this. I happen to be where she was demoing. So I'm going to lay this in here. I'm going to grab the Gala Glitz, and I'm actually just going to go ahead and put some on there. And then I'm going to come back and press it in place with my finger. But the coffee filter really allows me to capture all of that, and I find it easier to use the filter than I do a piece of paper, because this stands up, the stuff tends to not roll off because you've got those little beads in there. But you can see what happens. How awesome is that? Now I've added sparkle, I've added different kinds of shapes, there's glimmery stuff in there because those little tiny beads have a metallic coating on them. So again, I'll come back with some more of the glue. I'll put some down here. And then I'm just going to start putting glue, and you can see I've got some pieces that are coming off. I'm just going to start putting glue in random places so that I can go back and get some more of all that marvelous glitzy stuff on there. All right, so let's wipe this up again so we don't get glue where we're not expecting it to be. I'm going to press my Gala Glitz in place. Knock off the excess. And you can see what's happening. Now, I might actually just kind of leave this the way that it is. I like the idea that the color flows up along the side and then around the top. I'm not necessarily certain that I need it down there, although there's nothing to say that I couldn't come back with some of the Inca Gold and add some more highlights. Once you get this part done, then it's just a matter of setting the box in place and gluing it down, and that's what I'm going to show you next. The last step to assembling the shrine, and this is irrespective of what you're doing to the inside, this is just the final step in taking all of the pieces and putting them together, is to take the box that you previously glued together and to put it on the back. Now, the process is identical. It doesn't matter if you've got a plain back like this. If you've got a back that's part of a larger whole, like this is the wings, because there's the big old clock shrine, and then there is the castle and the butterfly wings and the sunburst shrine, the process is always going to be the same. It's to take that assembled box, align it on the back, and again, you can do this, you can feel with your fingers when this is aligned properly, and you're going to glue it in place. So you're going to take the same super thick tacky glue. You're going to run a bead of it along here, bearing in mind that the neater you are gluing now, the easier your life will be afterward when it comes time to clean up anything that kind of smushes out. Once that bead glue is on there, you're going to set this straight down on the back, get it aligned, and you can, honestly, for when I do this, I find if I stand here, because this glue tends to set up reasonably quickly and because it's so thick to begin with, I don't put elastics around this or anything like that. I just kind of hold it in place with my fingers for 30 or 40 seconds, and then most of the time it's fine. You're going to just leave it alone and let it continue to dry. Now, I haven't decided what I'm going to do with what I have here, but I certainly have ample options because I can sit this on here, and then I've got my butterfly shrine. Excuse me, my wings shrine. If I had one of the butterfly backs here, I could show you that, but I don't. Or I could just go with a standard box shrine like this. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that we have feet, and some of these kits will include feet. And that means that you can paint the feet to match. You can put 2 feet on here if you want. And the bigger kits we're going to package with 2 feet. The smaller 3x5s. We'll package like this with a single foot because it's really too small to put another foot on there. So you'll have the option to just work with a shrine as a box, like this, or to work with it as a footed element. And, you know, we'll sell these separately so that you don't have to buy the feet if you're really not interested in making one that way. But between the shallow shrines, the 4x6 and the 3x5 plain box shrines, and then all of the other ones that are built off of those, whether you're working with the small version that's built off the 3x5 box or the large version that's built off the 4x6, There's probably a dozen or more different styles here, and there's so many ways that you can work with these that the sky really is the limit.